It's good to be here. This is a tough talk to give this morning. I'm frazzled. Everybody I've talked to in the last 24 hours asks me to make sure I say a particular thing or that I not say a particular thing, and my head is just sort of stuffed with all of those. I should have written them all down, and I could have just knocked them off. My job this morning, as I see it, is I've got two big things that I've got to try to accomplish, and one of those is to explore the research a bit. We need to look at how we've been making certain choices in reading education, and how those choices, in some ways, have made trying to implement something like the Common Core much harder. Any of the states that maybe don't have Common Core, frankly, a lot of those are trying to do similar kinds of things, and so it blocks them as well. And the second thing I've got to do, if I can persuade you that the research is right on this, and that we've got to change our routines in some important ways, the question that nobody is bothering to answer is, what do you change them to? I mean, it's been fascinating to watch this whole thing unwind. I helped author the Common Core standards and have some sense of what the write-in team's goals were and what they were trying to do. And I don't think anybody involved in that had any sense of how difficult it would be to change behaviors in some of these areas, how deep the belief systems are, but how little alternative thinking has been done that would actually give people something positive to do. I'm a former first grade teacher. And one of the things I learned pretty quickly as a first grade teacher is, if you tell kids not to do something, that works for about 15 seconds. You've got to tell them to do something. And I sort of feel like that's what we've been doing, telling you what not to do, but not really helping you to figure out where things are going. Now, I've got this list of shifts, and I know there are some other ones, and I picked what I thought some of the biggest ones were. These are good things. Heck, there's at least one item on that list that wouldn't be there if it wasn't for me. Maybe two of them, perhaps, but certainly one. These are all good things to do. And yet, if we did most of them and did them reasonably well, I don't think you're going to see big leaps in reading achievement. Oh, yeah, a little bit. And the reason I'm saying that, I mean, it's not that I'm against these. Clearly, I'm not. But my point is quite simply that if you do some of these things well, the achievement points tied up in them are pretty small. The effect sizes that you'd expect to see are really small. And so these are good, but they're going to give you very incremental kinds of gains, with one possible exception. And that's the one we're going to talk about today. This notion of teaching with complex text is the one item on the list that honestly could lead to big gains. In fact, gains of the size that we need to accomplish if kids are going to graduate from high school at the kinds of reading levels that they need to be to participate in our civic life, to participate in our economic life, to participate in the social life of this society. But of course, anything as powerful as that is also something that can screw things up. Right? It's a little more dangerous. And so I've got to walk a very fine line on this talk. Some of you have seen, people were even doing this last night in the bar. essentially, what I talk about weightlifting for the simple reason that I want to make the point that exercise without weight doesn't do you much good. You know, exercise without some kind of resistance doesn't do you much good. And that, frankly, our standards for the past 30 years, 35 years, have focused very heavily on a set of skills and abilities that we want kids to develop, a number of, you know, actions that we want them to be able to take. We want kids to be able to draw inferences and draw conclusions and make comparisons and do all those wonderful mental actions while they read, but with no attention to how hard does the text have to be, how much weight has to be on the bar. These standards change that. They specify an amount of weight that has to be on the bar in grades 2 through 12. They specify how difficult the texts are that students need to negotiate. Now, in some sense, that's the easiest thing in the world to do. All we have to do is buy some different books. Right? I mean, that solves it. Now we have harder text and everything will be fine and we can move forward. Except it's not that simple. It's much more complicated than that, it turns out. And so, you know, specifying weight is important in this case, specifying these difficulty levels that kids have to learn to accomplish. But doing this changes, frankly, the entire conception that underlies all of our reading instruction. It changes all of it. We have, for a very long time, at least a couple of generations of teachers, we have conceptualized reading as being a set of skills and abilities that if you learn to fire off those different actions, everything's going to be hunky-dory. That's something that even people who say they're not real skills-oriented apparently have bought into when you look at their write-ins and what they have to say about reading. And I would suggest to you that when we set text complexity as this standard, as the way we have, we re-articulate reading as not being just some set of static skills that you've got to master, but it's much more like teaching somebody, say, to climb a mountain. How do you learn to negotiate a cliff? How do you learn to negotiate, you know, various kinds of wall faces and such? That this notion of negotiating the language and the ideas of all these different texts is a very different conception than just, oh, if you have these skills, now you can go climb mountains. Oh, and I did the wrong one. And see, now we have no presentation at all. I knew that was going to happen. One of the reasons why the standards do this, this study that ACT rolled out a while back, ACT, the people who, you know, test kids to see, you know, who should get into college. One time I presented this graphic in Florida, and a very nice young woman went to the trouble of making a really pretty slide of this that I could use, because she felt so bad for me with this sloppy little. And I really like, it's a much nicer slide than the one I have in front of you, but I actually didn't want to switch it out. I wanted this one to look just as ugly as it does, because I wanted you to see, these aren't my data. These are ACT's data. This is actually from a report that they published. It's not something that I published. This isn't something that I'm screwing around with. This is, you know, these are real data based on 500,000 American students. And it is an example. It is just an example, because there have been studies done since the early 1940s right up until like a month or two ago, people are publishing these studies. No matter what standardized reading comprehension measure they've ever done this kind of study on, they always get the same answer. What you see here is a chart showing how students at different levels of performance on the ACT, how they perform in reading comprehension. And not surprisingly, the x-axis, that's the row at the bottom of the chart, 11, 12, 13, all the way up to 36, those are the kids' ACT scores. And the y-axis, that is the column on the left-hand side, that gives you the percentages of reading comprehension questions that the students are answering. Not too surprisingly, the kids with really low ACT scores have lower comprehension than the other kids. That doesn't shock anybody. But can you see that there are two lines being summarized there that are, going the diagonal running across the chart? One of those lines is summarizing how kids do on the literal recall items. That is, the items where the text asks for some information and the text actually provides the information right there. The kids just have to find it or remember it. And the other line is all those higher order reasoning questions, the inferencing and interpretation and such. What do you notice about the two lines? Really close together. In fact, those little spaces you see, the statisticians tell us, are just noise. There's absolutely zero difference in performance on those right there questions and those higher order reasoning questions. They're exactly the same at every point of performance. So it's not, that's true for the low readers, but boy, once you get... No, it's true at every single point. Whether you're a low reader or a high reader, there's no difference in performance. Now, ACT should have known this, actually, but they soldiered on. They tried, what if we break our questions out differently? What if we have our main idea questions and our supporting details questions and our vocabulary questions and our relationships among characters and ideas questions and our drawing conclusions questions? Then what happens? One line. There's one reading comprehension tests measure a single skill if you try to do it this way, breaking it down by all these different question types or skills. It's one skill, reading comprehension. There aren't all these little things. All these people who go through and use their data, they're told, use your data. What that means to most people is you go through those comprehension tests, you try to figure out which kinds of items the kids are doing well on and which ones they aren't. And what you're really looking at is test noise. And you're going to teach to the test noise, which is crazy, because that won't work, and it hasn't worked. Oh, the main idea part of Junior's brain isn't working right, so we're going to... He'll read a bunch of little passages and answer multiple choice main idea questions till it's fallen out of his ears, and then he'll do better on the test. Except that just doesn't work, can't work, because there's no real difference in the performance on main idea. The reason I'm using the ACT example instead of some other ones, frankly, is because of this chart. ACT did something that the other researchers didn't do, and it was notable, and it very, very important in this case. Because instead of giving up, they were, what you want is the lines to jump apart. You want to be able to find something diagnostic that you can do. You want to find something that differentiates some kids from others so that you can do something with that instructionally. Well, they figured out how to get the lines to jump apart. But it wasn't by looking at question types or skills differences. It was by looking at passage differences. If kids were asked to read easy passages, they could answer almost any kind of question. If they were asked to read really hard passages, they could answer almost no kind of question. What makes the difference is the text that you're reading. And thus the standards have started not to ignore the skills. If you look, most of the standards are skills, except for this one that says all those things that kids have to learn to do, they have to learn to do them with text as hard as is specified in the standards. I don't want to talk about that. Let me say one thing about this slide and the next one. People make a big deal about this difference between quantitative and qualitative analysis of text. And I I was just someplace where I was talking about this, and it was really clear that people saw these as two very different things. And so let me just maybe straighten this out. Readability, this notion that some texts are harder than others, that they vary in how readable or how comprehensible they are, is an idea that goes back literally thousands of years, but we've been measuring it now for almost 100. The first study on this comes out in 1921. What these studies do and have done for almost 100 years now is they don't try to measure what makes a text difficult, they try to predict text difficulty. That's a different thing. Some people watched the Super Bowl recently. The bookies must have been dying the first half of that game because they predicted a certain outcome. And they predict those outcomes the same way that we predict readability differences. Literally, you go in and find some variables that you think are important that'll differentiate the winners from the losers, or in our case, the third grade books from the fifth grade books from the seventh grade books. And then you try to come up with the most efficient algebraic sentence that will essentially, you take each of those variables, you weight them in certain ways, combine them, and it will give you a prediction. Oh, this book will be understood by sixth graders. And what that means is the average sixth grader will read that kind of a text with about 75 to 90% comprehension. And it sometimes works. And sometimes it doesn't. The same way that when they predict the outcome of a football game, it sometimes works. What most of the studies on readability have found over the years is we can predict, we can make a pretty darn good guess about who's going to do well with the text and who's going to struggle with it with only two factors. If we know something about the words in the text and if we know something about the sentences. Remember, I said they don't really try to measure what makes a text difficult. They're trying to predict, and you just need an efficient predictor. If I were trying to predict a football game, I'd want to know the quarterback's rating. I want to know maybe the coach's record. There are various things. What does the middle linebacker's rating? But you don't want too many variables in your algebraic sentence, and so you're going to try to come up with something really efficient. Well, in the reading of text, you can do it with just knowing about words and sentences. What do you have to know about words? Well, all the measures do it differently. Some of them count the number of letters in each word. Some of them count the syllables. Some of them count how rare the words are. All that kind of stuff. Sentences, most common thing is count how many words are in them and figure out what the average sentence length is. Fairly longer sentences tend to be more complicated than shorter sentences. You can come up with exceptions to this, but generally it's true. And they predict how hard text is. Once you've made a prediction, however, once you know how hard a text likely is going to be, you don't have any information at all about what kinds of supports kids are going to need to read that text. Because you remember, all you've done is predicted how hard this is. You don't know what's making it hard. That's where qualitative looks come in. It's not, we're going to do this measure qualitatively. No, you're going to do the measure quantitatively, and then you're going to make adjustments, or more importantly, you're going to make decisions about how would I teach this? What is it that's going to trip kids up? If this text is as hard as my prediction says it is, I've got to get in there and figure out what might be tripping kids up and what might, so that I can guide them, so I can support them in an appropriate way. So I can skip that, and I'm going to skip that, and I'm going to skip that too. The fact is, the standards have done a few things. One of the things they've done is they've, as I said already, they set specific levels of difficulty for that kids have to learn to negotiate grades 2 through 12. A second thing they did that those other slides I just skipped summarize is what you used to think, say, was a fourth grade text they've raised the level on. So, you know, oh, if we teach reading with what 10 years ago we thought was a fifth grade text, that is a text that the average fifth grader would be able to read with 75 to 90% comprehension, these new standards are saying, no, we want to move these up. The texts we're going to match to a grade level are going to have to be somewhat harder. And a third thing that they do, besides specifying the text and specifying them at levels higher than they've been, they discourage us from doing what we've done for at least 70 years, which is when a text is hard for kids, we tend to move them to an easier text. And so, now they're telling us what text to use, they're making them harder, and they're telling us that our major tools for dealing with these texts have to go away. In fact, I might as well do it here. I know I forgot to put a slide in here, so I'll do it now. What do we do now if a text is hard? How do we handle that? What do we do if kids are asked to read something that we know by definition, because we've chosen it this way, we know that most of the kids in the class, even decent readers, are going to struggle with it? And I would tell you from my classroom observations, I see four common things. I see four common responses that teachers make. One of those choices I'll talk about at length in just a couple of moments, but so I won't say much about it now, but it's the one I just mentioned. Gee, this text is too hard for my kids. I'm going to put them in one that's at their level. So the other kids will use this one, but you know these kids can't. They're too low. A second choice, very common one, I'll read the text to the boys and girls. I was hearing some of that last night, right? I mean, with the group I was hanging with. If the text is really hard, if we read it to the kids, then they get the content, which is lovely. But what a lousy way to teach reading. That doesn't work. No, I mean, geez. So that's a bad choice. A third choice, one a lot of high school teachers have made for years, you don't have to read the book. I'll tell you the important information from it. I can do PowerPoint every bit as well as Tim Shanahan can. I can present the kids with what's in this science book that's going to be on the test, and they can read the book if they want to. Which if you ask a 14-year-old, I'll guarantee you they don't want to. And then, of course, there's the old-fashioned way. You just assign the hard text, call on Statue of Liberty girl, you know, the one whose arm's always up in the harbor. And don't even notice that some of the kids can't read it. You know, it's not your problem, you're a teacher. Now, it's obvious from your reactions that putting kids in easier text, telling the kids what the texts say, reading them to them, instead of having the kids read them, or just ignoring the problem, those don't work. Those aren't going to raise reading achievement. This notion that somehow, because the standards are requiring us to buy harder books, has now fixed some problem, hasn't fixed anything, because all it's done is thrown us back on a bunch of routines that we know don't work. I want to get in on that notion of moving kids to less challenging text, but let me just take a little side journey here. If you read your standards closely, and we tell you to do close reading, so you should read them closely. There are really two conceptions of complex text in the standards, and I'm watching people choose the one they like, which is interesting because both conceptions are there. And so people go, oh, yeah, I think that complex text thing is really important. And then you hear what they're doing, and they're leaving out half of it. So let me just clarify that for a moment. The idea that the states have set these levels that our kids have to be able to negotiate means that they're using things like Lexiles and Atos and Source Raider and all of those kind, Flesh Kincaid and all those kinds of estimates of text difficulty, which are based, remember I said they're based on vocabulary, they're based on syntax, they're language variables, they're about language complexity. And clearly we have to do that. But there's also a very strong theme throughout the standards about the importance of content, the thematic sophistication of the work, the depth of the content and such. Are there any secondary folks, high school? Okay, welcome to you folks. Good to have you here. English teachers at our junior highs and high schools, our middle schools and high schools, are, I think, have become just absolute geniuses at selecting content-rich, thematically sophisticated texts that are really simple to read, that have almost no language challenge at all. I remember a teacher in Indiana when I was kind of going on and on about this raised her hand and said, "Well, I guess this means I don't get to teach To Kill a Mockingbird anymore." "No, you're still allowed to teach To Kill a Mockingbird," I told her. "You just can't follow it up with The Old Man and the Sea and The Red Pony and all the..." There is nothing wrong with asking kids to read something that is utterly beautiful, like To Kill a Mockingbird, but that is in such simple language that, frankly, everybody in your class can read it easily. What I said to her is, "What if you followed it up with Turn of the Screw?" She says, "Well, that's Henry James, that's too hard." Which is the point. When are kids going to get the opportunity to deal with the complexity of language, not just the depth of the ideas or the sophistication of the theme? We've got to do both. And so it's not a choice, it's both. It's not pick the one you like. Are there anyone with reading degrees in the room? Anybody a master's degree in reading? Oh, look, yeah, welcome to you. That's good. Don't be ashamed, that's not a bad thing. You must recognize some of the names on these lists. These are all like past presidents of the International Literacy Association and members of the Reading Hall of Fame and so on and so forth. And every one of them has written, every single one of them has written about when text is hard for kids, you ought to move them to something easier. Basically, the idea has been that students learn most when they're taught from texts that match their instructional levels. Some of your schools use some of these programs, I bet. Everyone, and you know, honestly, that first list of experts I showed you, I could show you pages of that if I wanted to. I just wanted to show you that the smart people in the room tend to be saying you've got to move kids back to easier text, as do all these programs. And I could do many slides of that as well. Lots of times, are there special educators in the room? Got any special ed folks? Or we kept them out? Oh, no, there they are. Okay, that's good. I don't know why we segregated them. I mean, you can sit any place, really. It's okay. A lot of times the special education folks and the reading education folks argue with each other. We don't always play nicely. But boy, on this issue of whether you should move kids to easier text, this is one where special ed and reading, you know, we're together, as are people who teach second language. This notion that everybody has to be taught at their level to be successful in reading is something that, well, again, the smart money has always argued for. We did a survey, it says 2013 on this slide, but that was when it was published. We collected data nationwide from upper elementary, middle school, and high school teachers to find out about their instructional practices starting in 2010, and now we're going back these many years later to see what's changed. But one of the questions of the teachers was, how do you select the materials you use to teach kids to read? Do you do it by grade level? Do you do it by instructional level? Do Do you do it by interest? Do you do it by content? You know, what's it, you know, do you have some combination that you use? Well, you know, what is it? Fill in the blank. You know, some other scheme you've got? Almost two-thirds of fourth and fifth grade teachers said that they all the time put kids at instructional level. That's when they're working with reading, they know. Now, whether they all do it or not, they know to say it. 64% of teachers, and more than a third of the middle school teachers, and even a quarter of the high school teachers. This is something that is not just argued for by the experts. This isn't something that the companies out there, the publishers are supporting. This is something that teachers are doing. We've got studies. We didn't include primary grade kids in this study, but there are such studies that go back to the 1960s that suggest, if we're talking like second and third grade, it's like 90-some percent of teachers who are doing this. So I doubt that that's changed very much. Right? Where does this idea come from that everybody has to be taught at their level? Well, if you go back and hunt through and look, you know, all the citations and such, you figure out it comes from a man by the name of Emmett Betts. Betts was a reading educator back in the 1940s, 50s, and 60s. He was a big shot. He was the one who came up with the idea that all readers have an independent level and an instructional level and a frustration level. You know, an independent level, right? What does that mean? Students can read this text by themselves with, you know, get learning and understanding, and it's all going to be lovely. You don't need a teacher with a text that easy for a student. At the other end, frustration level, this is a text so hard that even under the guidance of a good teacher, the kids aren't going to make progress. So avoid it at all costs. We don't want kids frustrated. And the instructional level, the Goldilocks level, the one where it's just right. Where there's going to be some challenge, there's going to be some words kids don't know, there's going to be, you know, some ideas that they aren't going to grasp immediately, but that we can actually teach students and they'll make progress, they'll make optimum progress. It was Betts who came up with how you measure these criteria. The idea that the instructional level was like 95 to 98% accuracy, and the, you know, and your comprehension level would be 75 to 89%. That was Betts. The notion that you'd use an informal reading inventory, or today what most people would refer to as a running record, it was Betts who said that's how you measure this. I mean, that's where this all comes from, a textbook that he published in 1946. And he said in that textbook that this came out of a study done by one of his doctoral students during World War II, good Irishman, Patsy Aloysius Kilgallen. Old Patsy Aloysius did a study that, according to Betts, showed that if you taught kids at their instructional level, they made more progress than if you taught them at the independent or the frustration level. Every teacher since then has been trained in that if they took reading courses. Would it bother any of you to know that that study wasn't actually done? Well, they did a study, but not of that. This is something I discovered many years ago because I went back and found the dissertation and I read it, which very few people had done. They tested a group of fourth graders, small group of fourth graders, gave them an informal reading inventory, and they looked for how many word recognition errors kids were making when they were able to answer 75 to 89% of the questions. That was the study. They gave these kids a test once. There was no teaching, there was no learning. We came back later and tested them. There was none of that. They just wanted to know what the relationship was between fluency and comprehension. And that's where the numbers came from. Made up. Just made up. As a teacher, as a primary grade teacher, I never, ever, ever had a class that I didn't test every single child one-on-one with an informal reading inventory. I never taught a class where we didn't have multiple reading groups. Now, we didn't have all the little books that you have now, but we could buy different levels of different basal series and so on and put them together. I always had multiple groups at all their levels, and I was sure this is why people thought I was a good teacher. This is why I had some success. So I was a little shocked to find out that this was all just made up and that there was no evidence supporting it. That kind of blew my mind. What I have on this next slide, and that I'm going to not do justice to, is I have the pretty much all the studies that have been done on this topic since 1946. And I'm just going to take a couple minutes to run through them really quickly. For example, there were a series of studies done by, well, actually a Floridian, a guy by the name of William Powell, who was at the University of Florida for years. Back in the 60s and 70s and 80s, Powell really redid that Kilgallen study again and again, and with obviously larger samples of kids, and with kids not just at one grade level, but from first through eighth grade level. And he found a couple of interesting things. One of the things he figured out was that the relationship between fluency and comprehension changed grade level to grade level, which meant that at some grade levels, kids could tolerate a lot more difficulty than they could at other levels, you know, at other grade levels. And therefore, the instructional level, he believed that there wasn't a single one. He thought there were a whole bunch of them differentiated by grade level, and that, frankly, the text had to be quite a bit harder than what Betts was arguing. Now, Powell's work has widely been cited, but he's always been cited in our field as a kook. Seriously. And the reason he was a kook is because we know what the right instructional level is, and this guy came up with different numbers. The fact that he'd actually done more research on it and included more kids and done a, you know, a better job of the study didn't seem to faze any of us. Went to his grave thinking he was a kook. One of his students, Colin Dunkel, did a study where they didn't intervene. It's not an experiment. It's not any of that kind of thing, which you'd really want to see. But what Dunkel did is he went out and tested kids at the beginning of the year to find out their instructional level, and then monitored the kids' learning across the year, tested them again at the end to see how much gain they made, and then went back and looked to see what kind of placements were leading to the biggest gains, and was finding, in fact, that when kids were placed in much harder texts than what our traditional instructional level said, those were the kids who were making the most learning gains. Another similar study done with a different sample of kids, Jorgensen did a study with third, fourth, and fifth graders, very similar kind of study. They found absolutely no difference. It didn't matter if kids were placed at their instructional level or their frustration level. The amount of learning that they accomplished was the same. People like to cite this study to say, oh, look, you know, there's more research on this than Shanahan is saying. And yet they don't like to talk about the finding that it didn't make any difference. Didn't affect learning at all. All this effort to get everybody to their level was a lot of work and not any payoff for the kids. Oh, finally, Morgan. 2000, 54 years after we start recommending this to you, somebody decides to try it. Imagine if we did this in medicine. I've got some new cool medicine, folks, that's going to be really wonderful, and I want you all to take it every day, and in 50 years, we're going to test whether it helps. We get the first attempt, the first experiment done. Alyssa Morgan and her colleagues take a bunch of second graders. They test them with the DRA, an informal reading inventory. They find their reading levels, and then they take these children, and they randomly assign them to three treatment groups. So you guys over here, you'll be treatment group one. You're going to be taught at your instructional level. You're going to work in books that match, you know, if you're a second grader, if you're reading at a second grade level, you'll work in a second grade book. You guys here in the middle, You're just like them. Remember, random assignment. The difference is we're going to put you in a book that's two grade levels above your reading level. So if you read at a second grade level, you get to work with the fourth grade material. And you guys over here, you're, again, just like them, but you're going to work with material four grade levels above your reading level. Now, we know how this is supposed to come out. These guys are going to make the biggest gains. You guys will probably learn something, but not as much of them because it wasn't quite as good a placement. And you guys are going to burn the schools down. What we used to say in Chicago was, it's going to be like reading hieroglyphics, right? It's going to be so hard for these kids. They're going to be so frustrated. They're going to act out and misbehave, which is a myth, by the way, but okay. They do this. They come back at the end of the year. They test the kids. You're going to be pleased to know all the groups made some gains during the year. You guys who were so perfectly placed made the smallest gains of anybody. Smallest gains, not the biggest, the smallest. You guys who are 2 years above your instructional level, who are clearly at frustration level placements, you outperform them by almost a full grade level on the test. And you guys who I said were such a disaster, you didn't do as well as that middle group. You were sort of about halfway in between the two groups, a little closer to the 2 year difference than to the instructional level one, but in the middle. Everybody did better than the group over there. What it looked like to the researchers was that, in fact, having kids at their instructional level was limiting their opportunity to learn. Right? There were so few words to figure out in these texts. There were so few ideas to figure out in these texts that being in the harder text gave kids a greater opportunity to learn. It's a study people don't cite very often. Published in a good place, too. They're starting to cite it. I'm having an effect. They're paying attention now. But what they're telling folks is that, okay, it's true Morgan found that, but an average teacher would not be able to provide the level of scaffolding or support or carry out the instructional routines from that study. It's just beyond the skills of an average teacher. So let me take a minute to tell you what the scaffolding was and what the intervention looked like. It was 15 to 20 minutes a day of paired reading. Now, I don't know about your teachers, but in my schools, I had 26,000 teachers that I was responsible for. They could do 15, 20 minutes of paired reading. I mean, that's not a that's not beyond my teacher's skills. The scaffolding was largely done by seven-year-olds. Now, they were the better reading seven-year-olds, admittedly. But again, my average teachers are, they can scaffold as well as a seven-year-old. They really can. There was nothing done in this study that was, you know, over the top in terms of the instructional routines. A couple other quick studies. Renata O'Connor, a special educator, did a couple of studies, one of which gets cited all the time and one of which almost never gets cited. Just last week, Nell Duke, a professor at University of Michigan, sent me an ad that she saw from, and I won't name the program because I'm not trying to hurt anybody here, but where they were claiming, oh, they had all this research showing that placing kids at their instructional level made such a big difference, and they cite O'Connor, 2002, and you know, it's this, again, this, we go in and we pick the cherry that we want. We're not going to look at all the evidence. What O'Connor did is she worked with kids with IEPs. These were disabled readers. These were kids with learning disabilities in grades 3, 4, and 5. The highest readers in the sample were reading at beginning second grade level, so obviously most of the kids reading below second grade level. She had the kids tutored in, well, you'll never believe, phonological awareness, phonics, vocabulary, fluency, reading comprehension, so nothing you've ever seen or heard of before. Again, you know, a randomized controlled trial, so, you know, kids are, you know, they're going to get tutored in those things that I just talked about. Three groups, one group, a control group, they don't get any of the tutoring. The other two groups get tutored. The only difference between the two groups that get tutored, one group gets tutored with grade level materials and one gets tutored with books at their reading level. At the end of the treatment time, They test the kids. And just the opposite of what I told you Morgan found, O'Connor found that, in fact, the kids who were placed at their reading level did a bit better than the kids who were placed at their grade level. In fact, here's the first piece of evidence supporting this whole theory, this whole infrastructure we put in place. Now, a couple things about the study. She measured their gains in a number of ways. She looked at word recognition. She looked at decoding. She looked at reading comprehension. I think she looked at a couple others. The kids only improved in the foundational skills, but these are important skills. I don't want to downgrade this. But there was an interesting thing in the study that she pointed out. O'Connor's a very thorough researcher. She didn't just find a statistically significant difference between the groups. She went in and looked at the data herself. And what she saw was that the differences seemed to be with the lower half of the distribution. That is, that the advantage that this being at grade level, being at instructional level was giving kids wasn't general to the whole sample. It was to those lowest readers. And remember, if the highest readers were reading at a beginning second grade level, one assumes the lowest readers were reading first grade, kindergarten, certainly lower than second grade. Something she doesn't tell in the first study was that she saw a confound. She saw something that she thought might be, that she hadn't controlled for, that she thought might be affecting the results. She explains that when she and her research team publish a follow-up study, similar study, published in the same journal. And in this case, what they did, what she noticed was, this was tutoring, right? So each teacher is acting as tutor. So Dave is one of my students. And when I'm working with Dave and a kid makes a mistake, I tell him the word. Margot here, when a kid makes a mistake, she has him sounded out. This young lady has him try to guess. This one says, just skip it. Everybody was kind of doing their own thing, and she was worried that some kids were getting more teaching than others. And so what she did, she goes back, does the same study. The only difference is she has everybody use the same routine in responding to kids' miscues. So, you know, we're all going to do, you know, whatever it is that she wanted them to do. We equalize that. Now she runs the study again, and guess what? Absolutely no difference. Made no difference that these kids were at their reading level. They did just as well, made just as much gain if they were at their grade level. It's interesting, nobody likes to cite that study. They leave that one out, even though the same research team, same journal, just a finding they don't like. Final study is a series of studies done by Melanie Kuhn and Steve Stahl, where they put their fluency-oriented reading instruction, 4E, up against guided reading, you know, the Founis and Pinnell style guided reading. The kids in 4E are taught with grade level. These were, the first year were second grade students, and then they followed them for 2 years, so second and third graders. But essentially what they found is the children in the 4E classrooms, where the kids were working with grade level materials, not instructional level materials, their kids were way outperforming the guided reading kids. That was true at the end of, in fact, it was so true at the end of second grade that they decided to carry the study on for an additional year. When they carried it on the additional year, the kids even increased the amount of advantage they had. Very similar kind of finding to what we're seeing in the that Morgan study. That's the universe of studies that we've got to go on, guys. With the exception of that O'Connor study that she couldn't replicate the finding on, that was only true of kids at a reading level that the standards tell us not to try to, you know, give kids challenging text. All the studies find either that kids should be in harder text than we've been telling you, or that it makes no difference at all. But here's the kicker. I showed you that list of all those smart people. Showed you all those programs that all those smart publishers put out. I told you that all those different fields have endorsed this idea, and that a very large percentage of our colleagues are doing it. Are they all idiots? Is everybody just stupid? Was I a stupid teacher? Why has this been so popular? Why is moving kids to easier text so attractive to teachers? And I would argue it's because we've been in classrooms. We see what it looks like when kids can't read the book. We're better off, one would think, moving kids to something easier if it allows them to participate, if it allows them to be engaged. It's awfully hard to imagine how somebody's going to learn if they can't even read the text. And so the issue becomes, if we're going to move kids to harder text, can we facilitate that in some way that makes sense in a classroom? And is there any evidence that we can do this? Well, the basic, in fact, I can skip those. Let me just jump ahead, see if I can do this. Is there any evidence that it's possible to put kids in really hard text, scaffold it in some way so that the kids perform, well, as if they were placed at their instructional level? And it turns out there's a lot of that kind of evidence. In fact, see that list? Every one of these studies, they've intentionally put kids at frustration level materials. They've then introduced some kind of scaffolding that a teacher would do. And when they would measure it, these students were reading these texts as if they were at their instructional level. In other words, they'd be recognizing 95% of the words. They could answer 75% of the questions. It suggests that instead of this notion of placing kids at an easy level, what we have to do is place kids in the kinds of texts they need to be in, and to scaffold it to the point where it is at an instructional level. That an instructional level is an outcome, it's a goal, it's not a starting point. Oh, and I said all those studies did that? Those two. Yeah, I found 24 of them. A lot of studies. So then the question becomes, okay, if that's so possible, what are some of the things we can do? What I'd like to do is use the rest of my time to just show you some of those. And I'll show some examples. We won't get through all of these, but I want to give you some. So let's start with this one. Readers do not just take in information. Learning is interpretive. When they read a text, it has to be filtered through their knowledge. We always interpret anything through the lens of information of what we know, what we already, and we interpret through that, and we combine that new incoming information with what we have. I think it was David Pearson who defines reading comprehension as building bridges between the new and the known, right? The stuff that you know, that's in your memory, that's in your mind, with the new information that the author has given. Text can be challenging to readers if they presuppose or require the use of particular prior knowledge if you don't have it. You know, if this author is depending on you to know particular things and you lack that knowledge, it's a lot tougher to make sense of a text. But research has shown that we can guide kids to use their knowledge and their experience to scaffold new knowledge. This is one, frankly, that's in every textbook. This idea of, let's have some background discussion. Boys and girls, we're going to read a story about a family that's going on a vacation. Have you ever been on a vacation? Well, tell us about your vacations. And then, you know, 20 minutes later, we're going to read the text. This is one I don't have to convince teachers to do. Like I say, it's built into the programs. It's been built into teacher education for a long time. You rarely see teachers not doing some kind of a background step. I'm going to suggest we overdo it and we do it poorly. That we ought to be doing this better if we actually want to use it as a scaffold for dealing with challenging text. Prior knowledge can cut multiple ways. Yeah, it helps you draw inferences. It helps you to take out ambiguity from a text. It helps you to hold things in memory because you can put it into memory structures that already exist. So it's a good thing. Studies show that if we get kids to think about a topic or give them some information about the topic, if they don't have it before they read, it tends to improve their comprehension. It reduces the amount of work you have to do. I'll give you a simplistic idea. Here's a text that's going to present 50 ideas. And we'd like the kids to learn as many of them as possible. And some of you already know 40 of the ideas, which means you can focus your attention on learning the 10 you don't know. And you can use all your reading time and all your effort for that. Of course, that poor kid who knows one of the ideas or none of the ideas has to try to master 50 of them. That's a lot tougher, right? That's, oh my goodness, that's going to be a tough slog. The problem is that one of the things readers do, and in fact listeners do, is they'll sit in a room like this, they'll hear a talk, and they'll go, I know that. Right? It starts to allow you to start blocking things out. I don't have to listen to this because I already know a lot about reading instruction. So I'm going to miss any new ideas. In fact, even if he contradicts something that I believe, I might not even hear it. Research shows, and I've gone back through this and looked pretty carefully. I can tell you, research shows, I said it's helpful to prime prior knowledge before kids read. It doesn't look anything like what we're doing in classrooms. If you look at the studies, priming prior knowledge typically meant this group is just going to be asked to read a text and we're not going to do anything with them. They just read it cold and we'll see what happens. And this group, we're going to do something crazy. We're going to tell them what topic they're reading about. Tell them the topic. That was the priming. These guys knew what they were reading about. You guys had to figure that out. These guys did better. How long does it take to say to kids, we're going to read about such and such topic. Let's move on. You don't need that 20-minute discussion of what happened on your vacation and, you know, my brother threw up in the car and all that stuff. It's not really necessary. Similarly, prior knowledge tends to overwhelm it. If you have preconceptions, you tend to stay with your preconceptions. You tend not to notice where the text contradicts. Studies show that when prior knowledge contradicts text information, students reject the text information. They just don't even see it. Which means, for example, in science classes, instead of encouraging kids to think about what they know, on a lot of science topics, we try to do just the opposite. Can we get them to kind of not pay attention to what they know and focus strictly on the text? Just give it a close read. So I'll stay with this notion of prior knowledge preparation has to be brief. A good deal of what we take kids through as preparation for reading a text tends to be irrelevant. That example of the kid telling about his brother throwing up in the car has nothing to do with the story they're going to read. It's not really happening. I've lifted this out of the research literature. This is an old study, but I think it's pertinent. And this is from a basal reader that they were using in the study at the time. This was back in the 1970s. But here's the passage that the kids were reading. Three men came to get their hair cut, but Stanley barked at them. The barber looked at William. Boy, he said, isn't that your dog? No, he said, he just followed me. He lives next door. Well, the barber said, that dog is keeping people out of my shop. There are people here ahead of you, but I'll cut your hair now. The story up to this point, in fact, the dog is William's. The dog is William's. What's going on here? He's in the barber shop. The dog is causing a commotion, and the barber says, is that your dog? And what does the kid say? No. You ask the kids, is that William's dog? No. He says no. It was his dog, the whole story up to here, but now the kid has said no, and it's not his dog. The kids are going to have some trouble here. What's going on? What is William feeling with all the men looking at him and the barber looking at him? Embarrassment? What's that? You know, what do you do when you're embarrassed? Well, maybe you avert your eyes. Maybe you run away. Maybe you turn red and get all hot around the neck. Maybe you lie. Kids, you know what the prior knowledge preparation for this story was? A discussion of barbershops. My point is, the hard part of understanding this particular passage is the emotions. The unstated emotions. What is this kid feeling? What do people do when they're feeling that? But what the discussion is taking him on to is, we're going to prepare him. We're going to review prior knowledge. And this is set in a barbershop, so the kids have to know what a barbershop is. Doesn't help with this story. That isn't where the trouble is. If you can get the kids to have a discussion about what do you do when you're embarrassed, what might embarrass somebody, that might be profitable. If students have relevant prior knowledge about a topic or a hard-to-comprehend text, prime relevant knowledge briefly. Often a topic mention is all that's needed. Be strategic. If the prior knowledge is from prior readings, like, we're reading a chapter book, and we've read the first three chapters, reviewing what's known up to that point is very appropriate. That, again, I'd argue, is strategic. If students lack relevant information that the author assumed they were going to have, then you can provide that information. I was watching a high school class recently reading John Updike's The A&P. Some of you know the story. It doesn't hurt at all to tell the kids before they read it, A&P is a grocery store. They're not going to know that. In the 1950s, when Updike wrote that, people knew that. It was common knowledge then. Nothing wrong with telling them that. Or, use a core reading program, and they've got a selection from Charlotte's Web. They're going to have the kids read chapter 6 of Charlotte's Web, and it's terrific. But you know what? There are 5 chapters that E.B. White assumed the kids were going to have the information from when they read chapter 6. There's nothing wrong at all with saying, kids, let me tell you what happened in the story up to this point. Or there's something, there are a couple of characters you might not be too clear on, but they were introduced in an earlier chapter that you're not going to read. Boom. Nothing wrong with that. Sometimes those meaning gaps that I'm talking about are cultural. That the author assumes one set of experiences and the readers in your class have a different set. A lot of times people can surmount that, but it can help to talk about those differences before kids confront them. Let me give a second example, and this one I think is also done widely and not done terribly well. And that has to do with vocabulary. And a number of those studies that I was talking about, the way that they scaffolded is they pre-taught some of the words. There are words that are hard in this text. If I can introduce those words to you ahead of time, I can cut the distance between you and this text. And it works. There are all kinds of studies showing that that works. That helps. There isn't a program out there that doesn't recommend the teaching of vocabulary. But let me show you some of the things that we do. Like, I've got this passage on photosynthesis from fourth grade. Photosynthesis may sound like a big word, but it's actually pretty simple. You can divide it into two parts. Photo is the Greek word for light, and synthesis is the Greek word for putting together, which explains what photosynthesis is. It's using light to put things together. And it goes on to explain that, this is how plants make food. Guess which word the publisher wants you to pre-teach? You got it. How does that help? That's pretend help. I get in trouble with this with my wife. Some of you know what I'm talking about. Mansplaining? You know what I mean? Ladies, have the men in your lives ever explained things to you that you understood every bit as well as they do? How is this going to help? If the author's going to tell you what photosynthesis is, if I tell you what it is before you read it, it helps because you don't have to read it now. That's not going to teach anybody to read. So my rule would be, you can teach any word in that passage, but you can't teach photosynthesis, because that's pretend help. If there's some word that you think the author used to explain photosynthesis that the kids don't understand and that the author isn't defining, fair enough. Go through and look at your lessons and see what the publisher's recommending or what your teachers are recommending, because I think you're going to find a lot of the words that they want you to preteach are words that the author is going to explain. Photosynthesis would be a good comprehension question for this passage. It's a lousy vocabulary word to preteach. Or look at this example. Scientists argue that these gases have heated up our atmosphere. They say global warming will affect our climate so dramatically that glaciers will melt and sea levels will rise. In addition, it's not just our atmosphere that can be polluted. Oil from spills often seeps into the ocean. And my question is, none of these words are defined here, but can kids figure out the meanings of any of the ones I've highlighted? Is there enough context that you think, in this example, a fourth or a fifth grader would be able to get? Glaciers? Maybe. One way to find out, don't preteach it. Make it a comprehension question. Ask about glaciers. If they don't get it, you can go back and take them into the story and figure the article and figure out, you know, what it is from context. In fact, we claim we teach context, but when you look at reading lessons, we spend very little time asking kids the meanings of words from the text that they're reading that we expect them to figure out. We do exercises, we have worksheets, we do all kinds of things with context, but we don't often do that. And I'd argue that if we paid attention, we wouldn't be pre-teaching some of the words we are, and those would become great context questions. I'm going to skip this one. Great example, but I'm going to skip it. I want to give you some things that you haven't maybe seen or not very often. Sentence structure. I said that's one of the predictive tools is the sentence structure. In fact, that's the biggest part of those predictive tools usually is this. Explain clearly using at least three different reasons or drawing three diagrams why McClellan lost the battle. Or explain clearly why McClellan lost the battle, give at least three reasons, or draw three diagrams. Which of those is easier to understand? You know, most people find the second one to be easier. And I think you're right. But the problem is this. The first one is in perfectly good English. Why aren't we teaching kids to read that one with understanding instead of continually dropping kids back to the easy-to-understand one? Here's something I pulled out of a fifth grade selection. However, on August 24th, 2006, the International Astronomical Union, IAU, a group of individual astronomers and astronomical societies from around the world, made an announcement. I'm going to guess that a typical fifth grader is not going to understand that sentence. Why do I predict that? Because it has 26 words in it. Because it's got six commas in it. Because it has parentheses and numbers and an acronym. And so I'm going to bet the kids are going to struggle with it. Does it have a verb? Anyone find a verb? Made, yeah, the 24th word. Linguists tell us that when we interpret sentences, we do it from the verb out. You find the verb and you start connecting. You might not know that's what you're doing in there, but that's how you think about sentences or propositions as they refer to them. Imagine the 10-year-old, you've assigned this page of reading, he's reading it, and he comes to this sentence, and he starts reading. He's looking for a verb, tacitly, he doesn't know he's doing it, but he's looking for the verb. However, on August 24th, 2006, the internet, out of hell with it. When we talk to each other, we put the verb like the second or third word in the utterance to not overwhelm memory. What's happening, especially with informational text, and especially science within the informational text, is verbs in English are migrating to the right. They're going deeper and deeper into sentences. It makes them very different than the sentences that the English teachers like to teach. There are reasons for it that I'm not going to have the time to go into, but the point is somebody's got to teach kids to read a sentence like that. I'm going to suggest something very different than what I just suggested on vocabulary. Instead of trying to head kids off, instead of trying to figure out which sentence that you know the kids aren't going to know and pre-teaching it, I'm suggesting that you literally take a sentence like that and put a comprehension question on it. What did the IAU do? If the kids can't answer it, Let's go back and figure it out. And probably the first thing I'd ask him is, can you find the verb in that sentence? Let's go on a hunt. Let's see if we can find it. Or maybe I'll break it out for them. Maybe I'll give them a kind of a picture. That blue part is the subject. You can see how it hides the verb. Those subjects get bigger and bigger in science. Or perhaps I'll just do some kind of intensive questioning. You know, who was the sentence about? Who are they? What did they do? What did they make? When did they do it? In other words, taking the kids through the sentence. Not one way to do this. I want to show you at least one more, so let me jump ahead. The point, quite simply, is we can show kids how to read these kinds of sentences. I guess the fastest way to do this, since I'm out of time right here, let me just give this one example and I'll shut up. Another feature of language, one that's not measured in things like lexiles, is cohesion. Sentences have to cohere. Texts are not just lists of sentences. I've got an example here. Any of you have second language kids in your community? Oh, okay. The killer whale tosses the penguin into the air and generally torments its prey before it eats it. The killer whale tosses the penguin into the air and generally torments the penguin before eating it. Which one of those tends to be easier for your second language kids? Yeah, the second one. And the simple reason that it's easier to make the connection between penguin and penguin and penguin and prey. In our language, when you want to repeat a subject like penguin, sometimes you repeat it. Sometimes you use a synonym, penguin, prey. Sometimes you use a pronoun. Could have been he or it in this particular case. And kids have to make those connections. And the question is, to what extent are kids making those connections? Because I think in a lot of cases, you're going to find they're not. There were several roads nearby, but it did not take her long to find the one paved with yellow bricks. What does one connect to? What's it referring to? Roads, that makes so much sense, except it doesn't make sense because roads is plural and one is singular. But you're right. What about this one? Surely, said John, like one who had lost faith in his memory, he used not to sleep in the kennel. John, Wendy said falteringly, perhaps we don't remember the old life as well as we thought we did. As well as we thought we did what? It just sort of leaves you hanging. What does that connect to? Yeah, remember the old life. You've got to make those links. And if you can't make those kinds of links, you can't possibly understand it. And this one, the last one. I didn't know that Cheshire cats always grinned. In fact, I didn't know that cats could grin. They all can, said the Duchess, and most of them do. I don't know of any that do, Alice said very politely, feeling quite pleased to have got into a conversation. Now, we have an indefinite pronoun there, any. What does any connect to? Cheshire cats, and so Cheshire cats, they, them, the dialect for them, that's a tough connection for second language kids, but for any of your kids, there's another one here that I didn't even mention, I didn't even highlight, and that's conversation. What does conversation refer to? Takes you back to that, all those lines, right? The whole discussion between Alice and the Duchess. My point is, folks, that our boys and girls need to be presented with challenging, deep, rich texts that, yes, they cannot read at anything but what we would call it a frustration level. But by the time our lesson is done, those kids should be reading those texts at what we've always called an instructional level. And that means not reading the text to kids, not telling them what it says, but actually guiding them through, helping, supporting them in various ways with the ideas, with the vocabulary, with the sentence structure, with the cohesion, with some of the structural elements, and so on. If we do that, you could see kids not reading, oh, look, they got one more item on the test. You could see kids reading 6 months higher, a year higher. This is a sea change for us. And it's one that I hope that you will take as seriously as I do. If we do, I think our boys and girls are going to have much better lives than what would face them if we don't find ways of getting them to higher reading levels. With that, I will shut up and get out of your way. Thank you very much for being here.